Hello, and welcome back to The Good, The Bad, and The Ugly Show. So, as the summer's rolling in very slowly, I think it's time we did a summer music-y video. So today we're going to run through my top 10 least favourite Beach Boys songs. Kind of like a word storm kind of thing. A bit like a follow-up to my Endless Bummer video from a couple of years ago. Basically, this is 10 songs that I just don't think are very good, or I think they are really funny, or just ridiculous, or bizarre, you know? I just want to state right now that... I'm going to wave my arms around a lot in this video. Now, I just want to state right now that I am a Beach Boys fan. I don't dislike them. I've always liked them. They're a great band. Brian Wilson's a genius, and... a lot of their music legacy lives on and blah, 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 and all that stuff. So any Beach Boys fans tuning in, watching this, this is not a I hate Mike Love video and I love Brian Wilson video, even though it slightly is. That's not what I'm setting out to do today. It's just a run-through of 10 songs the Beach Boys recorded at one point that I might make a video about. We'll start with, well, Surfing. But this is not the original one. So the first song they ever did was Surfing. That kind of went out there. It didn't do much, but it kind of elevated them on the right track. From the early morning till the middle of the night, any time the surf is up, the sun is right. And when the surf is down to take its place, well, to the surfer stop, it's the latest dance craze. As this kind of surfy band, they went on to do Surfing Safari, Surfing USA, and all that stuff. But this is their very first kind of like song they did. So in 1992, they released an album called Summer in Paradise, and they decided to rework Surfing to kind of bring it up to the 90s, which it kind of failed to do either of those things, really. It's horrific. I'm going to play a bit of it right now. If you like that, fair enough, man. There's no accounting for taste at all. I just don't know, man. This was a point where Brian Wilson had left. I think there were legal troubles going on with Eugene Landy. If you know about all that stuff, then, or if you don't, go and research it. I'm not going to go into the whole Brian Wilson, Landy, Mike Love, legal battle stuff in this video. I don't have time. Basically, this was a re-recording. So this album was fronted by Mike Love, and I believe Terry Melcher had a big hand in it. It sounds like Terry Melcher has a hand in it. The whole album itself is... there's a lot of Kokomo's in there. There's some real nastiness in there. And there's a fair bit of... I've got stuff I quite like. So I do like some of it. I mean, and it's not... It's been cited as the worst album the Beach Boys have ever done. It's also kind of cited by some people as the worst album of all time. It could possibly be in that list. I don't know. I haven't looked that closely. But I wouldn't go as far. I don't know. I kind of like it. I mean, the problem with being a fan of a band like this is you're going to like all the terrible stuff as well as all the great stuff, and it's hard to decipher between what is good and what is bad. This song's bad. This is horrific. I can't say any more about it. I can just play bits of it, and it speaks for itself, really, isn't it? I don't know. What were they thinking? Who knows? Ask Mike Love. He might. Although, he has distanced himself slightly. So this album, a little bit more on this album. Basically, this is a bit of a battle for Mike Love, I think. I think he thought this album would do really well, I think, initially. So he was very disappointed when it didn't.
Which brings up a subject. We have a new album coming out the 1st of November called Summer in Paradise. Mm-hmm. We're better to have it come out than the beginning of summer in Australia.
Yeah.
So much so that he did a remix of it. A couple of years later, they remixed it, and I think they released that in England. Well, the song sounded slightly different, and that didn't seem to do anything either. And then about 3 years later, they appeared on Baywatch, that's right, as special guests, promoting songs from the album. I mean, that didn't do anything. I mean, I think after that, they just put it to bed and never talked about it again. This album is not on, like, streaming services. This is not on album collection, those big box sets that have all their albums in it. You won't find this in there. You might find a live version of Summer in Paradise somewhere on a Greatest Hits. That's about it, though. That's about as far as they go with this. So this album has been exiled from the Beach Boys canon. So, okay, so we got that out of the way. So let's bring us on to the next song I'm going to go on about for a little bit. Here Comes the Night. So this is from the LA album, which in itself is a weird album. As I say again, bits of it I like, bits of it are ridiculous. It's got stuff like Lady Linda on it and, I can't remember off the top of my head. I've listened to it 1,000 times, but it's an interesting album to say the least. I think Shumahama is on there, and that is definitely worth checking out, just for bizarreness. But yeah, Here Comes the Night. So this started off on an album called Wild Honey, and it was a kind of Motown-y type thing. I like that album, personally. So that album was 1967. That came just after Smiley Smile, which was the terrible outcome of what would have been Smile. Smile would have been amazing, more than likely, and it would have predated Sgt. Pepper and a few other psychedelic 60s albums. I think it would have been that big one. But obviously, that's been gone into. There's so many videos out there in the internet land that cover all of that, and you can just go and type it in to your keyboard, type in the Beach Boys Smile, just go out there. It's a minefield, man. Yeah, we won't go into all of that. So, let's focus on the next album. So, Wild Honey. I quite like it. It's a good album. It's a Motown-y thing. It's a more stripped-down sound. So, like, imagine, like, if Phil Spector kind of went for the opposite of what he did, like, the big wall of sound. Imagine if that was, like, a no wall of sound. That's kind of like, but the songs are still Motown-y. I'm going off into a tangent, but that's kind of what Wild Honey is like. But years later, inexplicably, they decided to revisit this song from that album in disco form. Yeah, so the Beach Boys finally did it. They finally went disco. I guess, at the time, it seemed like a logical step to take. The Bee Gees had broken into disco and they'd like gone completely, these days you'd call it viral, I guess. So this was like a couple of years later there, this is like 1979, so disco was already starting to go off the boil. People are already getting a bit fed up with it. In fact, certain radio stations had already banned the Bee Gees at this point. But I won't go into all that. But yeah, Here Comes the Night. This is inexplicably a disco nightmare, I think. You could lock someone in a room with this and send them mad, which might be quite a fun idea. Listen to a bit of it. It's just terrible, isn't it? On our radio show, on The Good, The Bad and The Ugly, if you tune in every Thursday on Phonic FM, It's another plug. If you tune into that, you can hear a little segment of the show that we call Disco Infernal, where we just play the nastiest disco music we can find. This song has featured on that, so yeah, it's got a feature on this. But it's a love-hate thing again. I kind of love it as well, but because it's so weird and nasty. And for me, that's, yeah, that's enough. So, right, next song. So, right now, a controversial one. Okay. So the Beach Boys, this came from a compilation, a bootleg compilation called The Beach Boys Get the Boot, which is quite a clever thing. This is like the end of their sort of Capitol years, I think, mainly focusing on that kind of stuff. But some stuff was recorded a little bit earlier. This track was definitely recorded a bit earlier. I don't know when from, I don't know why they did it. The Beach Boys sing the Battle Hymn of the Republic.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored.
Yeah, why? Why do they do this? There's a question. I read somewhere that somebody thought that Brian Wilson just had an amazing sense of humour and wanted to see Mike Love sing this and wondered if he could talk him into it. He did, I guess. But this does not help. This doesn't help the whole... I don't feel like I can say anything about this. See, not being American, I don't really want to get into politics about the whole Southern thing and all of that stuff. I don't know. Don't crucify me in the comments. But you know, tell me in the comments what you think about this. Is this okay? It's probably not, is it? Let me know. I mean, I'm not a woke person anyway. I'm not, you know. I don't know. Let me know. Let me know what you think. Let the comments go mad. If anyone watches this video, here it is anyway.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
Yeah. Okay. Probably enough said about that. It's quite a funny recording then.
You ain't Southern boys.
What next? So, number four, we're going to move on to a song. This is another song that hits the woke buttons again. Like the last one. This is another one that probably isn't okay. Like, I don't talk about this stuff a lot. I don't get political. But this probably isn't okay in today's society to certain people, or probably most people. But this is Hey Little Tomboy. Let's play some.
Hey little tomboy, sit here on my lap. I got things I gotta tell you.
So this is a real pass me the shovel. This is something I don't know. Why would I choose this? Because it's fucking terrible. I don't know what to say about it. So this is some creepy old men telling some young independent and some independent strong young woman that she should stop skateboarding and stop doing things that boys do and start putting on dresses and they will teach you how to kiss, and like, it's just creepy and fucking gross, man. It brings me back to this image of Mike Love.
So I am very much a ladies' man. I admit to that. Yes, life in prison as ladies' man. Just imprison me with a few ladies. That's all I ask. No, it's true. I do like girls.
Yeah. I don't know what more to say about it. It's gross. It's just gross. It came from... actually came from the album Adult Child. So Adult Child was another kind of aborted Brian Wilson, maybe genius, I don't know, certain bits of it I love. This was a Brian Wilson album about him kind of, you know, keeping his youth and stuff, and also a lot of this album would have been like kind of swing and orchestrated. It would have been a different turn in the Beach Boys kind of sound, which I quite like. Again, Mike Love apparently said, after Brian Wilson played him one of the tracks, Life is for the Living, which I absolutely love, it goes like this.
Life
for the living. Don't sit around in your ass smoking grass.
How could you not love that? Apparently after he played Mike Love this in the studio, Mike Love looked at him and said, "What the fuck are you doing?" Which is hilarious. So they should have released that. I don't know. I quite liked it. Instead, they took some songs off it and put them in other places. The MIU album housed a fair bit of that, I believe. That was an album mainly helmed by Mike Love, I think. It was about sort of transcendental meditation. Because Mike Love went off to LA, and there's an actual recording somewhere called Mike's Gone to LA, which became a later song and got worked into another album. I'm not going to go on about that. So next, it's not going to be the next one. Number five is not like specifically a song, it's more of a whole album, but the whole album is just, I don't know, man. It's another inexplicable thing the Beach Boys did for some reason or another, or maybe just one member of the Beach Boys did. It's a mystery about this album. So after reading the... I only discovered that this was an actual thing after reading the autobiography by David Marks called The Lost Beach Boy, which is a fantastic book. I recommend you read that. I absolutely love that. It's all about how David Marks kind of like got, well, kind of booted out. After storming out, he got booted out of the band by the Wilson dad. And he did other musical stuff, and he got into weird adventures, some of them with Warren Zevon, like taking a lot of acid. And his life kind of spiraled. It's just his story of what he did after like leaving one of the most successful bands, you know, in America at that time, and then trying to live with that and make decisions, and he eventually came back to them and all that stuff. It's a really lovely, lovely book. But he talks about how after he had rejoined the Beach Boys in the late 90s, this is after Carl Wilson had died, they put out this mysterious, weird album that only turned up in service stations, like a free, not a freebie, but one of those boxes you get on the counter of like a petrol station, which has got cheap CDs in it. This turned up in there, and it's called Mike Love, Bruce Johnston, and David Marks of the Beach Boys Salute NASCAR. So yeah, it's like a promotional NASCAR album that the Beach Boys recorded for NASCAR. It's horrendous. It really is. It's just a bunch of their old songs re-recorded very cheaply in a cheap studio with some session musicians. The people on here, so a lot of, I think Bruce Johnston says he's on there. David Marks, pretty sure that he's not on this album. I think Mike Love did this on his own, and he tried to kind of make it look like there's other Beach Boys in there. I think there was a couple of things he did like this, just to make a bit of, like, make a few quid. I think this is during a time when the future of the band was very uncertain. Obviously, the last remaining member of the Wilsons in the band had died, and so, like, what the hell do you do next? He was their guitarist, and the biggest name of the Beach Boys, probably, apart from Mike Love. So I guess they were struggling for ideas and for momentum. So yeah, what do you do in a situation like that? Well, obviously you go and record a promotional album for NASCAR. That makes perfect sense, right? But yeah, the album cover's horrific as well. You can choose any song off that album. I'm going to choose this one. This could be it.
Hi, this is Mike Love of the Beach Boys. As you've probably figured out by now, cool cars and hot fun at the beach have always been close to my heart. That's why I'm pleased to have recorded, with the help of Beach Boys Bruce Johnston and David Marks, and our buddy Dean Torrance of Jan and Dean, some of our all-time favorites.
And this is Bruce Johnston from the Beach Boys, beach lover, NASCAR lover, and the fuel that fuels me from high school all the way into my family life, 76. A million thank yous to Adrian Baker, our music producer, and I hope you enjoy our music.
This CD is brought to you by 76, the official fuel of NASCAR. And I'm hoping these songs will bring you as many good vibrations as a checkered flag at Daytona Beach.
Round, round, get around, I get around. Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty naff, isn't it? Pretty naff. So, they all sound like that. I mean, for years and years, this was on YouTube as a cassette tape version, so it all sounded worn and horrible. Horrible. All right, number six. We're moving on. We're getting through this. So, yeah, number six is a song called Baseball. It's also called It's Trying to Say, which is an even more confusing title, which I like better, I think. So, yeah, this song is a number one from Adult Child. I know I'm kind of picking on the album a little bit, but there's some weird shit on there. So yeah, this is a Dennis Wilson song. I mean, he later Dennis Wilson could be a bit of a target, I suppose, because his voice sounded a little bit on the kind of cracked, kind of cocaine burnt out side, I guess. But I love the what you call the a beautiful ugly voice. I love that, like Joe Cocker, like that kind of thing. Joe Fagan, another favourite of mine. So yeah, no, he's got that voice that I like, but this is ridiculous. This sounds like, it sounds like that fucking purple dinosaur Barney, doesn't it, really?
Oh, the baseball season's on. Get your season tickets now. Oh, those athletes work so hard.
Yeah, it's a ridiculous song, isn't it? You can hear it, played a bit. I mean, baseball? Oh, it starts off as a song where you're like, it's a corny love song, then it goes into baseball. It's just a promotional song for baseball, buying a baseball ticket. I don't get it. I'm British, we don't really understand baseball anyway, most of us, speak for myself and all that. So yeah, I don't know, man. It's another one of those weird things. Didn't get released anyway, so why the hell are we talking about it? Right, number seven. Number seven is, God, I'm picking on Dennis Wilson again here, but I don't mean to at all. I should be picking on Mike Love, not at all. But this has to be in here, and it has to be somewhere on this list. I mean, this list isn't necessarily a bad to worse, it's just a random list of songs I picked, shoved in a hat, and stuck out there. So this one, I Wanna Pick You Up. What the fuck can you say about this song?
Cause you're still a baby to me. Cribs and cradles and bottles and toys.
I mean, in some ways it could be a lovely song about some people, some you know, it could be a lovely song about your child, I guess. It could be a really creepy song about a woman. I don't know, but it's so corny. And they all sound, all members of the band sound like they're just fucking burnt out on cocaine on this one. I know I've said that again, but it does sound that way. It just sounds kind of worn, and everyone sounds horrible. Like, no one sounds, like, on point in this song. I love it. It kind of reminds me of that scene in Three Men and a Baby, actually. They should replace that with this.
I want to pick you up, rock you back and forth and make you smile.
See how that works? But yeah, this bit of the song is the bit that a lot of people kind of think, okay, what the fuck?
Pat, 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 pat her on her butt, but she's going to sleep, be quiet, pat, pat. Pat, pat, pat her on her butt. She's going to
pat her on her butt. But, yeah, I mean, why not? Why would you put that in there? So, number eight. This time we will be picking on Mike Love. So, yeah, this is gross. See, my only words for this song is gross. Remember, these are just my opinions. I'm not saying this is the gospel or anything. Gospel according to Bruce Johnston, I don't know, or David Marks, I don't know. This is just my opinion on what these songs are to me. So, you know, don't come for me, man. I know what Beach Boys fans are like. They can be feral, and they can be really quite scary, and they will kill me in the comments if any of them decide to watch this. I mean, it is called The Worst, you know, so I doubt they will anyway. But just another douchebag on the internet slagging off the Beach Boys. But I'm not really. As I say, I'm a fan, so, you know. But yeah, this song is called Bells of Paris. Yeah.
C'est très joli en Paris in the spring, watching all the lovers walk along the Seine. Pitch a penny in her like a wishing well. Feed the pigeons in the park near Tour Eiffel.
Yeah, Yeah. So, I mean, this sounds like a Christmas song as well. There's a funny thing there. It is a fucking Christmas song. It was originally called Bells of Christmas. It was from a Beach Boys Christmas album that was supposed to happen in, like, 1978 or 77. It never happened. They just, like, said, no, fuck that. Well, I think the studio said, fuck that. We're not putting a Christmas album out. You've got to do a real album, you bastards. So, I think that's why they went and had to rework it all and do something else. But, yeah, so this was originally a Christmas song. I'll play a bit of that there. And compare it here. Can you see what they did? Yeah, it's not for me. It's not for me. That's my only answer to this. I remember I put this on in my wife's car. I made her listen to this whole album while we were driving around. And I don't think she's forgiven me yet. I don't know. I'm still sleeping in the shed. So I guess time will tell. So number nine, we're going to move on to a controversial one here. A very controversial one. Because this was a hit, and people like it. And people will definitely say in the comments, what the fuck are you talking about? But I don't like it, and so I put it on my list. I put it late on the list. It is rock and roll music.
Just let me hear some of that rock and roll music. Any old way you choose it.
Now, don't get me wrong, I love the original. I love the Beatles version the best, probably, because the Beatles version has got this kind of, like, kick-assness about it. It's, like, immediate. It's got a kind of, even though it's an earlier 60s song, it's got a kind of heaviness about it that I like. The Beach Boys lacks all of that. It's just such a horrible kind of, like, it's like an old folks disco. You see the people boogieing very lightly in case they break a hip. It's not got any of that kind of oomph about it that the original had, or any kind of rock and rollness. They've managed to do a song called Rock and Roll Music and take all the fucking rock and roll out of it. I don't know. I don't know why it was a hit. I guess people were just feeling kind of nostalgic for the 60s by this point, and that is why. I think that is purely why it was. And I think the Beach Boys are a band in their later life. They really did, like, home in on this. Nostalgia. That was also a song from 15 Big Ones. It's not better mention the album. I've been mentioning the albums. 15 Big Ones were, I don't really like that album. Again, like, Shoot Me Down in Flames. But I thought it was just a bit cheesy, man. A bit cheesy. Some of the songs I know I love that same song was brilliant. It's funny, but it's kind of brilliant. I think it's off that album. I hope it is. I've got that horribly wrong. Again. But yeah, it's not an album really that I like. That was the Beach Boys comeback after sort of Holland and stuff, which I really do like. So I won't be mentioning Holland or Surf's Up or Carl and the Passions or any of those albums in this video, because they're stuff I consider to be fucking fantastic. So leave that out of it, man. Leave it out. So yeah, we'll move on to the last one. We'll move on to the last song. And this is probably another unpopular one. But it is what it is. And it is pretty fucking terrible, no matter how we look at it. It's fun. I play it to people to see their reaction. But it is terrible. And it is Smart Girls.
My name is Brian and I'm the man. I write hit songs with the wave of my hand. Songs of surf and sun and sand. I make great music with my band. Songs to dance to and songs of joy. Cause I'm the original Beach Boy.
So, not technically a Beach Boys song, I guess. This was going to be a song on a Brian Wilson album. I think this was Brian Wilson's second solo album. That didn't happen. This was going to be on there. Should the Beach Boys have stayed away from rap? So, Beach Boys' history with rap music. So obviously Wipeout and all that kind of stuff. They also nearly made a song with Bart Simpson, and that later went on to become the song from Somewhere in Paradise. I can't remember which one it is. It's the one from the Baywatch. I don't know. That one.
I can't wait till summer, cause it's gonna be a summer in love. Hey now.
Well, it's a love thing.
People all around the world in every nation like to get together for some excitation. If you're a girl who appreciates her recreation, why don't you let me take you on a love vacation? Yeah, I'll take you to the movies, but
let's see a bit more of that.
I'm a fool. First I'll get you on the beach or
So yeah, so the Beach Boys did. That was the Beach Boys' appearance on Baywatch. I love that. It's just so, it's terrible. Brian Wilson looks really like tired and just he doesn't want to really be part of it. But he had rejoined. So weird thing there. So obviously he wasn't in the recording of that, but he had rejoined the band at that point because they were doing a reunion thing in 1995, and so he had to be on the Baywatch episode. It's all so confusing, so confusing. But yeah, anyway, Smart Girls. Yeah, rap. The Beach Boys and rap music. No, not really. Not really. Everyone wanted this in the 80s, though. This was a thing that was going on, like Chubby Checker and like Wipeout and all that. And what's it, Twist and all that stuff. I don't know. Fat Boys, they got in on this, didn't they? Yeah, they did. But yeah, this is just a mess, man. This isn't Wipeout. This is not Wipeout. This is this. I don't know. I'm generous and I'll say that I love it because I'm a nice guy. Many people wouldn't say that. I don't know. But yeah, so that brings us down to that's number 10. So that is 10 songs by the Beach Boys. Another pointless video that people probably won't watch, but I thought I'd do it anyway. It's a nice day, man, and I want to talk about the Beach Boys and some not so good Beach Boys songs. So, you know, why not? So, yeah, that brings us to the end of this video. It's a glorious day, so go and grab your surfboard, go to the beach, hang five. I don't know what that means. But do it anyway. So, yeah, enjoy. Go and enjoy your day, and let us never speak of this again. But also, before you go, don't forget to subscribe. So, yeah, it's free to do it, and it helps me out. And that's it, really. Just it helps me out, and it's free. So do it, please. Thank you. Goodbye.